Hi, good morning or good afternoon. Today we'll be talking about this paper that is titled Association and Prediction of Amniotic Fluid Measurements for Adverse Pregnancy Outcome, which is a systematic review and meta-analysis published in this year in the BJOG journal. Yeah, so hi, I'm Kok Lun, and later our colleagues Jasmine Goh, Mansing, Li Mansing, and Tan Chong Yu will be presenting also. Okay, so I'm going to give a brief background on the topic. So what is assessment of amniotic fluid? So assessment of amniotic fluid is basically measuring the amount of amniotic fluid in the pregnant woman. They usually use amniotic fluid index or a single deepest pocket technique. So based on the measurements, you can actually assess whether there is oligohydramnios or polyhydramnios. So for AFI, usually is less than 5 cm, and polyhydramnios is more than 24, and the other method is called a single deepest pocket technique, and oligohydramnios is the depth of less than 2 cm, and polyhydramnios is a depth of more than 8 cm. Okay, so there are many different effects on oligohydramnios and polyhydramnios, and this is a comprehensive list of what can actually happen when you have these two conditions. And so, just to sum up what the paper is about, so the paper is actually talking about assessment of amniotic fluid volume and its association and prediction for adverse pregnancy outcomes. So what is the main clinical and scientific problem that is addressed by the paper? So what they say is that measurements of amniotic fluid volume are used for pregnancy and surveillance despite the lack of evidence for their predictive ability. So what their objective is to evaluate the association and predictive value of the ultrasound measurements of the amniotic fluid volume for adverse pregnancy outcome. And what they did is a systematic review and meta-analysis of the available literature. So the results from previous studies is briefly stated here. So in 1999, there was this paper talking about prenatal outcome in the amniotic fluid index in the antepartum and intrapartum periods, and they assess that there is a significant increase in cesarean delivery for fetal distress when the amniotic fluid index is less than 5 cm. And the other paper also talks about perinatal risk associated with borderline amniotic fluid index. And there is a twofold increase in the incidence of adverse perinatal outcome and fourfold increase in the incidence of fetal growth restriction. So based on these few papers previously, so what is actually the novelty of the story? So the study. So they said that they excluded some certain conditions like preterm rupture of membranes, underlying medical conditions, or fetal structure abnormalities in this study because it seemed to be the cause of, for example, oligohydramnios rather than the effect. And they also said that there are some inaccuracies inherent for these modalities, and they also said that they need comparison between AFI versus single deepest pocket.
For this paper, the type of study is actually a systematic review and a meta-analysis. So how do you conduct a meta-analysis is you gather data sources and you screen them and you make sure that they are of the correct quality before you clump all the data together for data analysis. So this is just a list of the database that they used and the keywords that they searched for when they were doing their data sourcing. So prenatal diagnosis, ultrasonography, amniotic fluid, and pregnancy outcome are the keywords and mesh term used. So for screening and quality assessment, they mainly look at the inclusion criteria. One reviewer will check the quality of the paper, and at least two reviewers will do the data extraction. This is just a detail of what are the inclusion criteria. So one, population. Pregnant women with or without fetal growth restriction. No evidence of premature rupture of membranes. No evidence of congenital or structural anomalies. Two, index test. AFI, amniotic fluid volume, and maximum deepest pocket. Tests that were taken. Any threshold used to define low or high amniotic fluid as reported by the authors of the included studies was accepted. 3. Outcome. Any reference standards looking at compromise of fetal or neonatal well-being were used. Any reference standard for fetal growth restriction or small for gestational age were used. Study design. Observational studies in which the results of the test of interest are compared with the outcome findings are as confirmed by a reference standard that allows generation of 2x2 tables to compute indices of association and test accuracy for each available threshold were used. Any case series of 10 or fewer cases and case control studies were excluded. For the quality assessment, it was done by at least one reviewer. So they use assessment tools such as QuadDAS2 and START checklist, mainly to look for any biasness in the studies. So good quality study features with little bias includes prospective design with consecutive random recruitment. They have full verification of test result with an appropriate outcome measure. They adequately describe population and index tests, and whether or not the clinicians managing the patients were masked to the result of the index test. For data extraction, this was done by at least two reviewers, with a third for arbitration if needed. They extracted information based on the study's characteristics, the population characteristics, information of how the diagnostic tests were carried out, as well as the accuracy of this test. Any duplicated data was priority was given to the latest publication. So now I will talk about the data analysis. So upon compiling all the data that they deem fit and meet their criteria, they'll pull the data together, and using random effects meta-analysis model, they can do a hypothesis testing. So based on the variables of measurement of amniotic fluid, like diagnostic test use, threshold use, they can compare with primary outcome measures of for small for gestational age, perinatal mortality, abnormal cord pH, adverse perinatal outcome for well-being, composite outcome measures. All of these can be analyzed using odds ratio to derive a predictive value.
Moving on to the results, this is a diagram showing the number of articles that were identified, and after exclusion according to the criteria, a total of 43 primary articles were included in this systematic review. This comprises of a total of 244,493 fetuses. The most common index tests reported in the papers were AFI less than or equal to 5 cm and MPD, which stands for maximum pool depth, less than 2 cm. The qualities of the primary papers were assessed, and it was found that there was good compliance with the population spectrum, adequate description of selection criteria, and appropriate reference standards were used. However, there was inadequate description of the index tests. For example, some thresholds of AFI were not defined, inadequate description of reference standard. Example, adverse perinatal outcomes were not clearly defined, and only a few reported blinding of the assessors of the outcome measures to the amniotic fluid measurement, and few reported if any treatments or interventions were done from the time of amniotic fluid measurement to the time of delivery. These were limitations of the primary paper themselves. From the papers, they found the most commonly reported outcome measures, which can be largely divided into three groups. Small gestational age, which they looked at the birth weight less than 2.5 kg, birth weight less than 10th centile. Primary outcome measures, which they look mainly at perinatal mortality, neonatal death, adverse perinatal outcome, abnormal cord pH less than 7.2, and other outcome measures, such as APGAR scores, admission to neonatal ICU, fetal distress, and morbidity. When they studied the association between oligohydramnios and small gestational age, they found significant association according to 5 meta-analysis. However, there was large heterogeneity and wide prediction intervals. As seen from the table below, if the AFI was less than or equal to 5 cm, it was significantly associated with birth weight less than 2.5 kg. And in specifically high-risk populations, it was significantly associated with birth weight less than 10th centile. These are significant associations as seen from the high odds ratio, there are more than 5, and the high positive likelihood ratio. It was found that for low-risk populations, the association with birth weight less than 10th centile is less significant. For the primary outcome measures, it was found that across all measures of oligohydramnios, there was a significant association with neonatal death and perinatal mortality, as seen from the high odds ratio. However, there was no significant association for abnormal cord pH and adverse perinatal outcomes. Moving on to other outcome measures, there were others reported in the primary papers, but only those with significant associations will be mentioned here. It was found that the association between oligohydramnios and fetal neonatal morbidity is only moderate as seen from the odds ratio between 2 to 4. There is a strong association with assisted ventilation and intubation and an APGAR score at 5 minutes less than 7. One study showed that for MPD less than 1 cm, there was significant association with fetal distress. They also went on to look at the predictive accuracy of AFI versus MPD. They found that whether they used AFI or MPD, there was no difference for the outcomes of APGAR scores, admission to NICU, fetal distress, neonatal death, or perinatal mortality. However, for adverse perinatal outcomes and birth weight less than 10th centile, there were improved positive likelihood ratios for MPD, but no change in specificity or negative likelihood ratio. For polyhydramnios, there were 5 papers that reported on polyhydramnios and adverse outcomes. The thresholds used were AFI more than or equal to 24 cm in 3 papers, AFI more than or equal to 25 cm in 1 paper, and the last paper did not report the threshold. It was found that there was a strong association with polyhydramnios and birth weight more than 90th centile, but no association with birth weight less than 10th centile.
So in conclusion, between oligohydramnios and low centile birth weight, there's strong association and low summary sensitivity. There's also the same type of results for between oligohydramnios and neonatal death. Between polyhydramnios and high centile birth weight, there's high association and low sensitivity. Between polyhydramnios and low centile birth weight, APGAR score less than 7 in 1 minute, fetal distress and neonatal death, there were no evidences of new associations. So what is the impact of all these conclusions? If the ultrasound finding shows that there is oligohydramnios, we would expect to have less than 10 centile birth weight and greater risk of mortality for the fetus. However, if the ultrasound shows normal amniotic fluid levels, we cannot accurately predict if there's any future problems or mortality in the fetus. Therefore, other prognostic factors are necessary. If ultrasound shows polyhydramnios, we would expect to have 90th percentile birth weight for the fetus. Other abnormalities such as PPROM, congenital abnormalities are not included. So in summary, the quantification and association and predictive values of the ultrasound measures were done in this particular paper shows that oligohydramnios is not an accurate independent predictor of adverse outcomes because of the poor sensitivity across many results. Other predictors are needed to improve the accuracy in predicting adverse outcomes. Oligohydramnios is still usable as a co-founder to control for in further studies. So in summary, clinical judgment where all the relevant factors that contribute to the disease is to be considered in diagnosis.